Once a Christian, thought about becoming a Jew, and now just an unspecified theist. And I've been asked, how come I just don't take the full plunge to atheism? Well, I'll explain my reasons, and you may find that they only make sense to me. I have been asked in the past by some of my atheist subscribers, in the comments section, how I can be so rational and logical in debunking the resurrection of Jesus Christ, or at least questioning the so-called evidence that the Christian apologists present, and then on the same note use that same illogic and irrationality to believe that there is a creator of some unspecified type, as I still claim in my belief system to lie somewhere between a Jew and an agnostic, an unspecified theist, which no matter how I portray it, believes in some sort of limited magic. And the atheist is right in those comments, because it doesn't make logical sense, rational sense, or reasonable sense. For the only thing we have to observe and interpret our reality is our senses. Eyes, ears, nose, sense of taste, what we can touch and what we can observe. And the simple fact is, as I've said before in another video, I don't try to present my beliefs because I don't have any proofs to present them with. If I argued with an atheist, I would lose. And I would lose in two words when he said, prove it. I have a hopeful belief that somehow the uniqueness of man, in what appears to be a battle of good and evil on this earth, somehow denotes that there's some sort of creator watching it all. And none of that belief system, which is really nothing more than hopeful belief, falls into any realm of evidence. A large purpose of this channel is not to discuss various belief systems, but to take what Christian fundamentalist apologists proclaim as evidence for Christ, his miracles, and his resurrection, and to determine whether it's actually evidence or speculation. And this inquiry started back when I was 13. Shortly before my confirmation into the Catholic Church. I remember thinking even then that I did not wholeheartedly buy that Jesus rose from the dead. It began to occur to me, even in that young age, that every religion had their sort of magic. At that time, I didn't even realize that we didn't have actual authorship of the Gospels, but I was beginning to wonder whether it was just members of a cult that created a fable that became an urban legend over the centuries. And over the years, after hundreds of hours of reading and research on the subject, I discarded Christianity as legitimate and wrote it off as just another novel religion. And I could possibly convert to Judaism, except I find there's no evidence that an Abraham existed, nor an Isaac, or that a massive exodus of Israelites ever fled Egypt under God's care. And I don't find the Islamic fables any more legitimate, nor the Buddhist beliefs of reincarnation, so that leaves me in the realm of the unspecified theist. And when I say that, that's when the atheist says I drop the ball of logic and reason into the abyss of illogic and anti-reason. And strictly speaking, he's right. So why would I hold on to this system of belief? Well, I'm probably the only theist who's ever gonna state the truth out loud. And it's the same truth that can be said to be the origin of every religion. Because everyone, including myself, has an innate fear of death. And if someone out there doesn't fear death, then congratulations, because you are the exception, not the rule. Even the very religious fear death. The evangelical Christian diagnosed with 4-stage cancer will fight as hard as he can not to exit from this earth. Why would he? After all, in his belief system, a blissful paradise awaits him. Because at the end of the day, in the back of our minds, no matter how devout you claim to be, that fear of death still lingers. And I wonder if you are incorrect about the afterlife. Just as I lie awake many nights wondering if a creator exists at all. So that's about as honest of an answer as I can give to the atheist in the comment section. And why do I, as well as everybody else, fear this death so much? After all, if you look at the amount of time we actually exist on Earth, in a universe that's several billion years old, and even with a mankind that at best has only existed a few hundred thousand years, our existences really are nothing more than a fleeting glance. And the reason we, including myself, want to adamantly believe that somehow we go on, once that etched stone is placed above our heads in the ground, is because our very existence is all we know. We could very easily say, of course, that there was a time when we didn't exist, and that is an infinite amount of time prior to when we were born. But we have no recollection of it, of course. It is an absolute mind-bender to try to comprehend our non-existence. And after we draw that last breath, that state of non-existence is a permanence that we can't comprehend as well. Some of you have probably already lost friends and family members. And you'll remember how after the funeral, it takes several years before you actually comprehend that they are never ever coming back. No matter how much significance you achieve on this earth, whether you're a homeless person or Julius Caesar, once that heart beats its last, that state of non-existence is forevermore, even if they're reading about you 2,000 years later. And I have to ask myself, which I do, because I try to be candid and honest in these videos, what would I feel if I woke up tomorrow and found out I was immortal? And the honest answer that nobody wants to say aloud is I probably wouldn't have a care whether there was a creator or not. But since I'm not immortal, I have a hope that there is one based on some subjective feelings and nothing more. And this is why they say the most venomous arguments are about two topics, politics and religion. People will argue about politics because if someone has an opposing viewpoint, the other thinks it's a threat to their existence on Earth. But if you have an opposing viewpoint on religion, you are now a threat to their afterlife if they consider it. And this is why people argue so aggressively about religion. Because like me, even though I'm an unspecified theist, they want to believe it. They want to believe they're going to go on. And they imagine if they can convince somebody else of their belief system, it more so reinforces that they are correct. And if enough people tell them that they're correct, then they can sleep a little lighter at night and not worry so much about the coming Reaper. And nobody likes to hear the atheist talk because he's telling all parties that nothing exists at all. And if you're strictly using the senses as your philosophy, which is the only legitimacy we have in terms of proof, then the only logical argument is the atheists. And that will bother all theists, from evangelist, Jehovah Witness, Mormon to myself, because you can't break down the logic of his argument. So would I proclaim that I have a thoroughly logical, reasonable, and rational argument on the topic of why I'm still an unspecified theist? No, I wouldn't. I have a hope based on pseudo-logic, made of feelings more than fact, subjective observations versus evidence, and regardless of all the reason, logic, and rationale that the atheist presents, I still have this thin thread that I'm hanging on to that once I close my eyes in death, that it's going to be revealed that the universe renders a tiny bit of magic after all. And if you'd like to read a novel also based on magic, with no evidence behind it whatsoever, check out my book, The Second Fall, an offbeat account of a future apocalypse of what I think Christ would be like if he actually came back. Entertaining to most and sure to offend the fundamentalist. On Amazon, link is in the video description as well as the banner. And I will see you next time as we once again take that sword of reason and reality and thrust it right through the heart of ignorance.